Okay, Kirk, we're at the Menard Correctional Facility, and we want to talk to you about this letter that you sent the DeKalb County State's Attorney's Office.
Okay.
Before we do that, I just want to read you your Miranda warning. You have the right to remain silent, even though you're not being charged with anything. I'm gonna go ahead and read these. You have the right to remain silent. Anything you say can and will be used against you in the court of law. You have the right to an attorney before we ask you any questions. You understand these rights?
Yes, sir.
Okay. If you could, could you go ahead and read the letter that you wrote to the DeKalb County State's Attorney's Office?
Yeah. I was told by Jack McCall that he was giving the little girl a piggyback ride and she fell. He said he did not mean to kill her. He said she would not stop crying and he was just trying to keep her quiet. Jack said he called the feds and after having a dream that the killer's name was Johnny and lived a few houses down from the girl. Then he tells me he used to go by the name of Johnny and he lived a few houses down from the little girl. He said the police made his wife open his safe and kept asking her if he hits her. He told me that you have subpoenaed two newspapers and that he had given interviews with. Jack said you don't have any more on him than you did 50 years ago. He said you will not find DNA, and if you do, then maybe he will make a deal. He said since he was a cop for 20 years, he will probably get probation. Jack claims to be a celebrity now, and if he has to, he will hire a dream team and embarrass you in court. This guy is a monster. Out of the blue, he said she was real pretty and his whole demeanor changed. He became excited and looked like a different person. It scared the shit out of me. I will testify to what Jack told me, whether you help me out for my testimony or not. Of course, I would love to have some hope of getting home someday, but I don't think I'll make it either way. My blood pressure is through the roof and I'm already on 10 different medications. I would like to do something good. If I can help this family convict this monster, I will. I have a court date, January 12th, 2012. If you were to put me back on G Block, I would go to MP with Jack again. I could try and get more out of him. You also have a case against Mike Greenwell. I was helping him with his case. It was not self-defense. He told me what happened. Kirk Swagger.
Okay. Okay. Kirk, here you can just put that right down here, just in case you need to look over that. Did anyone ask you to send this letter?
No, sir.
Okay. Did you write this letter and send it to the DeKalb County State's Attorney's Office?
Yes, I did.
Were you ever contacted by the police or any attorney and they asked you to write this letter?
No.
You wrote this letter on your own and in your own words?
Yes, sir.
Okay. The information in this letter, who did it come from?
Jack McCall.
Okay, you mentioned the MP, which stands for the multi-purpose room. And what do you do in that room?
Well, it's a room where they let us go to for 1 hour every day to exercise or read or watch TV or just talk. There's tables and
okay.
Chair.
And you were in what block in DeKalb County Jail?
G block.
The G block. And where was Jack?
Jack was held in segregation, and there's only two segregation cells, I believe. It was right across from the dress out room.
Okay, and during the conversation with Jack, this took place during recreational time?
Yes, Jack went to G Block every day with us. When we had MP time, Jack also went. At
okay.
the same time, so we were.
And why was that?
I guess he felt comfortable with G Block only, so they would allow him to go when we went. There's not a lot of time for every single block to go, so he had to pick, I guess, if he wanted any time out of the cell. you had to go with another block.
Okay. And do other blocks go into the MP room together?
No.
Not
usually.
Only one block at a time?
Yes.
But in this instance, the sheriff's office allowed Jack to get out of segregation, to go to MP, and he chose only to come during the G block time, your block time.
Yes, that's
okay.
Correct.
And how long were you in custody at DeKalb? Do you remember?
Approximately 2.5 years to 2 years, 9 months altogether.
Okay, and you were stationed, you were held there permanently, or?
No, sometimes the county jail would get overcrowded, and they house some inmates in Kendall County. So I was held there for a period of time at times, and then I would come back and forth.
Okay, you would come back to DeKalb for what reason?
For lawyer purposes, or like I came back approximately 3 weeks to a month before my trial, I was sent back to DeKalb so I could be closer to my attorney.
Okay. And how long were you in custody with Jack then? You remember?
Yeah, approximately the whole time I was back, approximately like 3 weeks to a month.
Okay. When did you meet Jack for the first time?
First time I met Jack was in the MP room, probably somewhere around the 1st or 2nd of August, somewhere around there.
Okay. And did he approach you in the MP room? Did you approach him? Do you remember how you guys were introduced? Or?
Yeah, he was speaking about languages, and somebody had brought up that I speak Spanish, that I could speak a little Spanish, and so we started talking about languages, and he started talking about some cave drawings and started mumbling on.
Okay. And in the MP, that's the first time you met Jack, because he was in segregation.
Yes.
Pretty much the whole time.
Yes. Okay. That was the only time I would see him, is in the MP room, or if I was, like when I was going in and out of court during my trial, I would talk to him sometimes through his cell door.
Okay. And you would, through a cell door, meaning you were just walking by his cell door and you talked to him, or how did that conversation?
No, he would talk to me through his door. I would, like right across from his door, from his cell door, was the dress out room in DeKalb County, where they would bring me to change into my suit. And when I was done, a lot of times they would tell me to stand by the door, or just to wait I'd have to wait for a guard to come get me, and we would talk through his door. It's approximately from me to you guys right there.
Okay.
I mean, it's about real close.
2 or 3 feet away.
Yeah, I mean, we're 5 tops.
And he would see you through his door?
Yes.
And then he would strike up another conversation with you while you were waiting to be transported over to the courthouse?
Yes, sir.
Okay. About how many times did that take place between the cell door and the dress-out room?
I don't know, probably 5 times.
These
5 times we talked. Probably.
And then how many times did you have conversation with him in the MP?
I don't know, maybe 4 times.
Okay.
Somewhere around there, I can't be exact.
4 to 6?
Something like that.
Okay. Okay. And one thing is also, why did you send this letter?
Well, as you know, I've already been convicted. I just felt, I just wanted to do something decent. I mean, my whole life I've been in and out of trouble, and I just kind of, was kind of bugging me with some of the things he said to me. And I just felt good about thinking about telling you guys, so I just finally decided to write it down and send it in.
Okay. Did you know about his case ever before?
I didn't know anything about his case. I did know that I've heard one time on TV that they were bringing back this guy who ended up being Jack, that was arrested in another state for a crime that was over 50 years old involving a murderer of a little girl. I just as far as I knew.
Okay.
That's all the information I knew about it at the time.
Okay. When you were in the MP room and you and Jack were engaged in conversation, were you guys sitting at a table? We know that in the MP room, you said you can sit at the table, you can read books, watch TV, maybe walk around and get some sort of exercise. When you guys were interacting, what were you guys doing?
Usually just standing there talking. Just standing there. I mean, probably on the other side of the room. Most of the time on the other side of the room, not probably, because the TV's usually right there, kind of loud.
Okay.
So.
Now, did he go over that way, or was that just circumstance? Was there anybody else around that would have heard this conversation, or did he kind of segregate you guys when you guys were talking about this?
He would talk to me more than most people because of my circumstance. I was in the middle of a trial. I was going to trial, and we would talk about lawyers, and he was also going to trial for the same, well, obviously not the same at all, but he was going to trial for, or he said he was going to take a trial for murder. So we would talk.
And you were going to trial for?
For a murder as well. I mean, a felony murder, not an actual murder.
Right, right.
Bad circumstances.
Did he say he felt comfortable talking to you because you guys were both in jail for, you know, the same charge? And
well, he didn't say it, but he would definitely, he would bring me aside, just talk to me, and okay. He would be quieter when he was discussing his case.
I mean, okay. Okay. Now, when in custody at the county jail, did you guys have access to newspapers or magazines?
No recent magazines. They have old magazines like National Geographic and maybe some Popular Mechanics magazines, but they were very old, and we're not allowed to get the newspaper.
To keep up on current events.
I've never seen any newspapers in there.
Okay. So, okay. And you said in the MP room you can watch TV.
Yes.
Television. What's on the television? Is it just one channel? You guys can only watch one channel, or do you have the remote? People can change.
You could change.
You could change.
Yes.
Okay. When you would watch TV, did you ever hear about Jack's case come over the news, or anything like that? What did you hear about Jack's case?
Like I said, I only seen it the one time, and it was before he even got into DeKalb County on the TV. That was it.
Okay, so you basically, before Jack was even there, on the television, you saw that there's an individual that's not in Illinois that is going to be transferred to DeKalb County for a murder of a little girl,
mm-hmm.
and that he was an older gentleman.
Yes, sir.
Basically, that's all that you knew about this case.
Yeah.
Until Jack informed you.
Until you guys started talking about cases and stuff.
Okay. Now, as far as the DNA, you mentioned in your letter that he states, he said you will not find DNA, and if you do, then maybe he will make a deal. As far as the DNA, did he go into any detail about DNA?
He just said that it was 50 years ago, there's no way they're going to find any DNA. If they did, then he would try to make a deal after that. And then he would go on to say that since he was in law enforcement and in the service, that he's one of their own and he'll probably get probation.
Okay.
Something similar to that, he said.
Okay. As far as the law enforcement, about him talking to you about his prior law enforcement, you mentioned in the letter that he was in law enforcement for 20 years.
Yes.
Okay, let me find that here.
He told me he was a cop for like 20 years.
Okay, so you're not... okay, he was a cop for 20 years. He will probably get probation. you're not just assuming he has 20 years law enforcement. He actually told you
that's
that.
That's what he told me.
Okay. Okay. And he also mentions in here that Jack said you don't have any more on him than you did 50 years ago. Meaning the police,
yeah.
They don't have any more on him.
Yeah, meaning the detectives, the whole case. You don't have any evidence. You don't have anything more than you did 50 years ago. And that, basically he's a celebrity and he's going to get away with this.
Okay, that's my next topic here. Jack claims to be a celebrity now. And you've got celebrity written in here in quotes. Does he mean by that? What did you take from that?
He's claiming to be famous now, that he's on all the TVs, and that any lawyer that takes his case will become famous because he's famous now. And he's a big shot, basically.
When he was talking to you about being a celebrity now, what was his demeanor like? Was he concerned?
He was excited. He was...
What does he think about this case?
He basically thinks it's a joke. He thinks that he's going to get away with this. That's what I got from him, is that he likes this stuff. I think he likes all the attention he's getting. I think he likes it. I mean, except for when he talks about that little girl, his whole demeanor changed. I mean, his voice would lower and his eyes. And it was like he was reminiscing when he talked about her.
Okay.
When he told me about the piggyback ride and
how
she fell, and he was trying to keep her quiet. She started screaming. And he was just trying to keep her quiet. It was an accident, he claimed. But the way he said it was real creepy.
Did he mention anything else about that night when he gave the little girl a piggyback ride? Did he mention anything else about that night?
He said something about there was another little girl there and that she had ran off and that she had started screaming and he was trying to keep her quiet.
Okay.
He said,
so he was saying that
an accident. That's what he was trying to claim.
Okay. Now he was saying that there he informed you that there was another girl there besides Maria.
That's what he said.
And that girl, you said she ran off screaming, or she just left?
He said it like she ran off.
Okay.
Like you know, maybe scared her.
Okay.
I mean, he didn't really specifically say that, but that's the way I took it.
But he said that there was Maria there. And another girl.
Yes.
And then that girl, the other girl left. And then did he say that's when he gave Maria the piggyback ride? And then that's when she fell and...
He didn't...
Or did he not give you a time frame?
He didn't say any times or anything. He just basically blurted out that it was an accident. He was trying to keep her quiet. He didn't really get into exact details or anything.
Okay. Now you said that you said in the letter also that he's a monster. What do you mean by that?
He just spooked me. Just spooked me pretty bad when he started talking about the little girl, and when he said right when he was done saying it was an accident, and he said in a real creepy voice that she was real real pretty, like creepy.
That's how he described her.
In a weird voice. He looked funny. Mm-hmm. Something was wrong with this guy. Something is wrong with this guy.
Okay. So, based on his reaction and his voice and his description of this 7-year-old girl, that made you believe that he was a monster.
It made me believe that he is a monster, definitely.
Okay.
Something's evil inside this guy.
Okay. And then you also mentioned here when he became excited and he looked like a different person, it scared the shit out of you.
That's exactly what I was talking about, when he started saying how pretty she was and I was an accident. When he talked about her, his whole demeanor changed. His whole demeanor.
Okay.
All right. It was creepy.
Okay.
In your letter, you mentioned that the police had talked with his wife. Tell me about that.
He said that the police had, or the investigators, were harassing his wife. They kept asking her over and over again if he had beat her, if he hits her. Questions like that. He said that they had forced her to open a safe that he had at the house.
And it was this out where he had lived, out west?
Yeah, where he was arrested.
Okay. Did he ever mention anything in regards to the night that he had given Maria the piggyback ride? What did he mention about, did he say where he went or how he got there or anything regarding that?
No, sir.
Nothing regarding the military?
Oh, I mean, he said... He said immediately after that he joined the service.
Okay.
I mean, that was basically about it.
But as far as the night that Maria, or the night that he gave Maria a piggyback ride, he never mentioned where he took her or if he just left or what he did. He never mentioned that.
No. I don't know if any of this is helpful to you guys. I just wanted to make sure I told you just in case. You know, I know this guy's pretty creepy and I just...
Okay.
I mean, I don't know if, like I said, if any of it helps. And I just wanted to write you guys a letter. I just trying to do something right for change.
I mean, right.
I just... I would write you the letter.
You're concerned.
Yeah. I mean, I don't know... if any of this, if you knew all this, or you know, if I know things that he told me, I just want to make sure you knew. I mean,
and apparently, since you have no access to newspapers, the magazines that you do have access to are old, and the only TV. The only TV that you watched regarding this instance was before he even arrived at the jail. Now, when he approached you at the jail, did you know that was the man that you saw on TV? Did you see a picture of him on TV?
Somebody had told me the guys on the unit were going to the MP room before me the day before, and they had mentioned that the guy was in there and that he seemed like a normal guy and all this, that was him. So when I went the following day, when I just assumed it was him and it was him.
Okay. And
I didn't know what he looked like or anything.
Okay. And basically he approached you because apparently somebody in your unit mentioned to him that you speak some Spanish. And they must have mentioned to him that you may be bilingual, and that's how the conversation came about.
Yes, that's how we initially started talking.
Okay, and you didn't see him. Every time you went to the MP room, he was there, but you would not go every day.
Yeah, that's correct.
Just because of stress with your trial and whatnot. That's the only reason why that you spoke to him about 4 to 6 times out in the dress down room?
Yes.
And through his cell door, and then about 4 to 6 times once again out over in the MP room.
Yeah, to be quite honest with you, after he told me those things, I didn't even want to talk to him anymore.
Okay, after he told you what things did you pretty
when,
much
when he started when he told me what he said about that little girl, and that when he's like sort of changed his whole demeanor
when he was describing the little girl
and he said she was so pretty, and I knew that he was guilty. I just knew it. He basically told me he was guilty, but he was creepy, man. I just didn't want to talk to him anymore.
Just because of his body language and his facial expressions and his
I mean, for someone to kill a little girl and rape her, you gotta be sick.
Yeah.
You gotta be sick.
Okay.
And to brag about it and think you're famous, and it just bugs me. It's one of the reasons I wrote you a letter.
Okay.
The whole thing just bugs me.
Basically,
I have kids too. I mean, I don't have a little girl, but I mean, I'll be the greatest guy, but I have a soul.
Mm-hmm.
Just this guy's sick.
Okay. And you, Phil, and Paul do send this because he like you said before, he thinks this is a big joke.
Yeah, he does. He thinks he's a celebrity. Thinks he loves all this attention, it seems. And
okay.
He doesn't seem bothered by it one bit.
Okay. All right. Well, I thank you for coming to speak with us about the letter that you sent into the state's attorney's office. And I think this will conclude our interview with you.